When I was a little girl, I used to love to go out late at night and look up into the sky to identify the planets and constellations that I could see. But my favorite thing to see was a shooting star because they were magical, here one moment and gone the next. What I learned later is that they're actually little pieces of our universe left over from the formation of our solar system and the planets, and they're called asteroids. They tell us about the origins of our solar system, and their orbits sometimes come into contact with the Earth. Millions of years ago, the dominant life form on Earth were dinosaurs, until one day, in a matter of seconds, the whole history of Earth changed. 65 million years ago, an asteroid 6 miles wide came crashing into what is now called the Yucatan in Mexico. Traveling at 50 times the speed of sound, Mach 50, its energy impact was a billion times greater than the bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima. The firestorm that was unleashed left a layer of ash and dust that covered the world and blocked out the sunlight for years. The dinosaurs never saw it coming. So fast forward to 50,000 years ago, the Earth was hit by a small asteroid in Winslow, Arizona, about the size of a small office building, about the size of this auditorium, actually. The result is this, the Barringer Crater. This crater is 4,000 feet across, 600 feet deep, and it rises 150 feet up from the plains. That's me just a few weeks ago when I had the privilege to hike down into the bottom of the crater with some scientists. It's truly awe-inspiring to see in person. Now, fast forward again, this time to just over about 100 years ago, to 1908, the largest asteroid impact in recent history exploded in an area called Tunguska in Siberia, Russia. Now, you may know that in war, bombs are set to explode in the air so that they can cause the maximum possible damage on the ground. The result of an asteroid impacting our atmosphere and exploding is that 3 minutes later, the shockwave arrives. This asteroid was about the size of the Arc de Triomphe in Paris, and it exploded with the energy of 300 times that of the Hiroshima bomb. And it flattened 830 square miles of forest, an area similar to the size of the Los Angeles metropolitan basin. Had that asteroid exploded just a few moments before or a few moments later, so that it was over a populated area like Moscow or London or Sao Paulo or New York, it would have been the defining event of the 20th century. And finally, just 3 years ago, on February 15th in 2013, a small asteroid, about the size of a train engine, exploded 18 miles outside of a town called Chelyabinsk, Russia. Traveling at more than Mach 50, the shockwave arrived 3 minutes later and blew out 100,000 windows and sent 1,500 people to the hospital. In Russia, everybody has a dash cam, so we have amazing pictures of this event. With no advance warning, world space agencies and government leaders learned about this asteroid on Twitter. Yes, Twitter. So to learn a bit more about these pesky space rocks, let's take a look at our closest neighbor in the solar system, the moon. Now, the moon doesn't have a protective atmosphere like ours. That's why it looks like this. All of the craters you see were caused by asteroid impacts. Now, there's two reasons why Earth doesn't look like this. We have an atmosphere that causes most small asteroids to break up before they impact Earth. And weather. Craters on Earth are erased by water and wind and hidden by vegetation. In fact, asteroids hit Earth more often than they do the moon because our planet is larger and we have a bigger gravitational field. Asteroid impacts are not rare. Let's see how often we get hit.
The Nuclear Test Ban Treaty Organization monitors the Earth around the clock listening for the infrasound signature of nuclear detonations. Between 2000 and 2013, this network detected dozens of massive explosions in our atmosphere. But not a single one of them was caused by a nuclear weapon. The actual cause, asteroid impacts. Between 2000 and 2013, there were 26 recorded asteroid impacts on Earth, ranging in energy from 1 to 600 kilotons. For comparison, the nuclear bomb that destroyed Hiroshima in 1945 exploded with an energy of 15 kilotons. While most of the asteroids shown here exploded at too high an altitude to cause damage on the ground, they do remind us that asteroid impacts are not rare. An asteroid large enough to destroy an entire city hits the Earth on average once a century. Because we don't know when or where the next major impact will be, our current strategy for dealing with asteroid impacts is blind luck. But we can change that. The next great space mission is protecting the planet. Join us.
So you see, asteroid impacts are not rare. We know more about what's outside of our solar system than what's inside of it, because governments and scientists have prioritized looking out beyond our solar system. What you see here is the dense green ring here is the asteroid belt, which is between Jupiter and Mars, and it's where most of the asteroids live. And their orbits stay relatively stable, but sometimes they get kicked out of the asteroid belt because they come too close to Jupiter. And then they enter our inner solar system. And those asteroids are called near-Earth asteroids. What you see here are the 14,000 known asteroids that we have found to date. It looks kind of busy, but those are the 5 million that we don't know where they are. So what is our current strategy for predicting asteroid impacts? Is there a way that we could prevent asteroid impacts? Yes. Could we stop an asteroid if we could predict one was coming? Yes. Yes, in fact, asteroid impacts is the only natural disaster we know how to prevent. Now, you could do that by getting a bunch of crack oil drillers and make a nice movie about it. Or you could earn your physics degree somewhere other than from the movie Armageddon. So in Armageddon, our heroes blow up the asteroid. In real life, we have better options. It's called deflection. We can deflect an asteroid by pushing or pulling them to change their orbit. A few years ago, NASA launched a spacecraft that rammed into a comet and demonstrated how we would deflect an asteroid. A complementary approach to refine the deflection is to use a gravity tractor, which would pull the asteroid using the gravity of the spacecraft to change the asteroid's orbit. Now, the European Space Agency and NASA have a proposed mission called AIDA, which will crash a spacecraft into an object and measure very precisely the deflection. In the future, we'll likely use a combination of both a kinetic impactor and a gravity tractor. So the headline is, we know the science, and we have the technology to deflect an asteroid from hitting the Earth. Kind of cool. Actually, it's pretty amazing. But do we have the time? The key to deflecting an asteroid is a matter of time. So Don Yeomans, the senior scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, says, the key to stopping an asteroid is to find them early, and then find them early, and then really find them early. So how much advance warning do we need? 10 years at minimum, 20 is much better. We have to factor in the position of the asteroid as it relates to the Earth, because we only have launch windows every few years. So planning is really key. So problem solved, right? Well, not exactly. Our problem is we don't know where they are. You can't stop an asteroid if you don't see it coming. So how are we doing so far? Turns out that NASA has found 95% of the asteroids that would end civilization. And as of today, we have found an estimated 14,000 of the asteroids in our inner solar system, of the estimated 5 million to find. It turns out that detecting asteroids is harder than deflecting asteroids. We have to not only look from the ground, but from space. Let me show you why it's hard. Asteroids are dark, like flying pieces of charcoal. And here's a typical asteroid. So what's the challenge in spotting small, dark objects in space? Well, they don't reflect light. Trying to spot a relatively small dark object far away against the dark background of space is really, really hard. Black background, black object, doesn't reflect a lot of sunlight. And if you're looking towards the sun, it's even worse, too bright to see the asteroid. And you can't stop what you can't see. So let me tell you a story about a little boy. If any of you have read the children's book, The Little Prince, his home was on an asteroid named B612. And he went looking for friends in the universe and traveled to all the asteroids around him. My favorite passage in the book is when the fox says to the prince, "What is essential is invisible to the eye." That's what I, along with a long list of scientists and engineers and technologists and citizens, believe. It is essential that we find what is invisible in our solar system. It's no longer hypothetical. How do we defend Earth? But rather, do we choose to defend Earth? Now, remember the black objects, the black asteroid flying through the dark sky, really hard to see? Well, two proposed space telescopes, NEOCAM and Sentinel, will be able to monitor and map asteroids and identify the ones that would come near Earth decades in advance. But how? Well, asteroids get warmed by the sun, and because the background of space is cold, we can use infrared cameras to see the asteroid glow in the dark. So we equip our telescopes with the equivalent of night vision goggles. An asteroid has to come into the space telescope's range to be seen. And once an asteroid comes into view, and if we can measure its position over a period of time, we can use our knowledge of orbital mechanics to calculate its orbit. And we're really, really good at calculating orbits if we have the right data. Now, there's good reason to be hopeful that we're making progress. The National Science Foundation in the United States has funded the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, LSST, and when operational in the next decade, high in the mountains of Chile, it will begin surveying the sky. Although LSST's primary focus is cosmology and dark energy, it is going to be really good at finding asteroids. In fact, it will find more asteroids in the first 2 months of its viewing than we have found in all of our history. So along with the proposed space telescopes like Sentinel and NEOCAM, and with the funded LSST ground telescope, we could discover, map, and track the asteroids in our solar system. So scientists in the future will be able to not only see these asteroids, but measure their orbits and know if one of them is heading our way. And once that happens, we'll dispatch a series of spacecrafts that will intercept the asteroid and nudge it so it doesn't hit us years later. We're literally going to geoengineer the solar system. In a very minor way, of course, but nonetheless, we will be talking about changing the course of our solar system. We're also making progress getting the world's attention on this issue. Last year, Asteroid Day was launched. It's a day dedicated to learning about asteroids. It's held on the anniversary of the Tunguska asteroid impact. In 2015, we had 150 self-organized events in 44 countries around the world. There's an incredible group of folks behind it, over 80 astronauts and cosmonauts, hundreds of scientists and business leaders, and thousands of citizens worldwide. Anyone know the rock group Queen? Perhaps the song Bohemian Rhapsody? Or how about We Will Rock You? Well, the writer of that song is the guy with the hair down there on the left, and his name is Brian May, and he's the lead guitarist for the group Queen, and he wrote those songs. What you might not know is that he's also an astrophysicist and is one of the co-founders of Asteroid Day. And he's helping us tell the world that we know the science and we have the technology to solve this problem. On Asteroid Day, people are learning about asteroids from scientists and engineers and teachers and astronomy clubs in their local communities. I'm hoping here in Lithuania and other countries will join in and celebrate Asteroid Day by organizing events with your local space agencies or your planetariums or museums or your schools or your astronomy clubs. Find the people in your community who know about asteroids and astrophysics and astronomy. They're an amazing group of people. I hope your country will join. In closing, the asteroid problem impacts literally everyone on Earth right now, and everyone who will be born in 100 years from now. We are not just passengers on spaceship Earth. We are the crew. Our challenge as a civilization is to detect these dangerous asteroids. We don't want to just stand by and watch another major asteroid impact Earth. We want to lie in our backyards decades from now with our children and our grandchildren and look up into the sky and say, "A long time ago, people were afraid of what came out of the sky, like that shooting star. But using our science and technology and brains, we have saved the Earth from the fate of the dinosaurs." So go outside, look up to the sky, be part of Asteroid Day, because this is an idea worth spreading. Thank you.